Welcome back. In the last lecture, we discussed a little bit about strict implication, and modal logic has emerged with a thorough dissatisfaction with respect to the material implication. So, when it is concerned with the material implication, we have two issues. That is, the first issue is this, that a true proposition is implied by any strange kind of proposition, and a false proposition implies anything. And Lewis has come up with another type of implication, which he calls it as strict implication. So, what is so different in this strict implication? Some of the things which we have discussed already in the last class, but we will be continuing with the things that we have seen in the last class. So, here are some of the C.A. Lewis's important observations on strict implication. First of all, he is not happy with. Happy, especially when Russell and Whitehead, when they talked about material implication, according to Lewis, it does not imply that, you know, Q is deduced from P. So, Q is deduced from P is not just material implication, but it is it has to be P, the antecedent of the conditional has to be strictly hooked to the consequent, that is Q. So, in this sense, P implies A implies B. If it is a material implication, the definition is like this: it is not the case that A is false or B is the case, or you can read it like this: it is not the case that A is true and B is false. Strict implication: A strictly implies B. This is a symbol that is used there. A strictly hooks something, B, it is defined as A implies B is considered to be necessary, or you can view it in this sense, that it is not possible that A is true and B is false. So, here if you write A implies B, of course, this can be written like this, not A or B. So, these are some of the important observations of C.I. Lewis with respect to strict implication. The ordinary meaning of P implies Q is that Q can be validly inferred from P, that is, Q is deduced from P. For example, if we have P all the way down, you will be deducing Q. So, Q is deducible from P. So, this is where Lewis is unhappy with this particular kind of thing. Whether deduction captures, deduction is captured by material implication or not. So, this interpretation, the one not P or Q, P plus Q is defined as not P or Q, he considered was subjected to paradox. If you view it in this way, it leads to paradox. What are the paradoxes? A true proposition is implied by any strange proposition, that means all tautologies should come as an outcome of any contingent or any kind of strange proposition, and a false proposition implies anything. And there are several instances of paradox of material implication. So, taking P implies Q synonymous with either not P or Q, he distinguished extensional and intentional meanings of disjunction. So, for any logical connective, apart from negation, we have conjunction, disjunction, implication and by implication. Each and every logical connective has its corresponding intentional connections, like, you know, intentional disjunction, intentional conjunction, intentional implication, that is strict implication, etc. So, he is trying to provide a sort of two different kinds of meaning for the word implies, P implies Q. We have to view it in this way: extensional disjunction is considered to be the usual truth functional connective. For example, if you say P or Q, the truth value of P or Q is solely determined by truth value of P, truth value of Q. That is simply viewed as, it is false that P is true and Q is false, Q is true. That is, A implies B is not A or B. An intentional disjunction is such that at least one of the disjoint disjoint propositions has to be necessarily true. This is the difference between intentional and extensional disjunction. In the intentional disjunction, either P or Q means it is impossible that P and Q to be both false. If either were false, the other would be automatically be necessarily true, but the negation of either implies the other one. Whereas in the case of extensional disjunction, it happens to be the fact that at least one of the prepositions P is true and Q is true. It is not true that both are considered to be false. But in the case of intentional disjunction, if you say P intentional disjunction Q, it means that either P or Q is the case. P or Q means it is impossible that P and Q be both be false. You are ruling out the possibility that P and Q is true. Usually when you write extensional disjunction, it is going to be like this. P or Q, it is either P or Q, or it can be both also. So usually we separate it with another kind of thing, which is considered to be inclusive. This is considered to be inclusive R. I'll write it here, inclusive R. So it's like either I take coffee or I take tea. If I will take coffee, and even I will be taking tea also. But inclusive R means P or Q, but not both of the things. So that means if you take tea, you will be restricted to take coffee. So that is not the one which I am talking about here. Extensional and intentional disjunction is the one which we are talking about. If you take intentional disjunction into consideration, Lewis is of the view that out of these two disjuncts P, Q, one has to be necessary, other one can be actually true, it is okay, but at least one of the disjuncts have to be necessary. So here is the distinction which he is trying to make with extensional and intentional disjunction. Once you thoroughly study the disjunction, of course negation and with negation and disjunction, you can easily come up with the implication, because A plus B can be defined as not A or B. As you are seeing it here, for the case of material implication, P plus Q is equated as this thing, not P, intentional disjunction Q, or it is equivalent to not P or Q. There is no such kind of distinction between intentional, extensional, etc. Everything is same, and that is same as it is not the case that P is true and Q is false. In the same way, if you take P and not Q, that is a conjunction. So that is equivalent to, it is not the case that not P or Q, is same as that one using De Morgan's laws, and it is same as it is not the case that not P or Q, and this is same as it is not the case that P plus Q. So first we talked about P plus Q, now we are talking about not of P plus Q. As you are seeing it here, all are equivalent to each other. So this is the main interesting observation that Lewis had made, and then using this observation, he could come up with a strict implication. And the idea of coming up with a strict implication is that he wants to avoid some kind of paradoxes. The paradoxes that we have seen are true preposition is implied by any strange preposition, falsity implies anything. These are some of the most important things that we need to address. Whereas in the case of strict implication, P implies Q, definitely it is not P inclusive or Q, sorry, it is not inclusive or intentional disjunction Q, but this is not equivalent to not P extensional disjunction Q. This is where all the difference lies. And of course, this not P or Q is equivalent to not of P and not Q. So these two are anyway is not equivalent to the first one, that is not P intentional disjunction Q. So this kind of equality will not hold for the sake of for strict implication. So this is, for this reason, strict implication is different from material implication. And with this while differentiating this intentional and extensional disjunction, Lewis has come up with intentional Lewis has come up with the strict implication, and we are hoping that this strict implication can handle at least paradoxes of some of the paradoxes of material implication. So how it can handle the paradox of material implication? Right now he is talking about this, that if you one of the instances of paradox of material implication is this, for example, P implies Q implies P. So if P is true, now this true proposition is implied by any strange proposition. This is considered to be any strange proposition. It can be contingent, it can be any other irrelevant kind of proposition, anything. So now viewing this implication as strict implication, maybe you can write like this: P strictly implies Q strictly implies P. Now according to Lewis, this is not a theorem and the logical systems that he is trying to come up with. He has come up with five logical systems from S1 to S5, and in some of the papers he mentioned it that the first two logical systems seem to be capturing the strict implication in a better way than the other systems. So there is an interesting book written by C.I. Lewis, A Survey of Symbolic Logic. This book is still used as is still serving as a classic textbook for us. It's an exhaustive survey of symbolic logic. So if we view it like this, this will become P implies Q implies P. Now somehow you need to show that this is not a theorem or it is not valid in your logical system, then you have achieved your purpose, because this is leading to paradox of material implication. That means truth is implied by any strange proposition. We don't want tautologies to be inferred from strange kind of proposition. So if we can somehow show that in a logical system, which we are going to talk about a little bit later, this does not come as an outcome of outcome in your logical system, then you have achieved your purpose. The purpose is that we want to avoid paradoxes of material implication. So these are some of the things, such as some more observations. So for analyzing a statement, any statement which includes intentional disjunction or implication, etc., we require non-Boolean operations like necessity, possibility, etc. They are all non-Boolean operators. What are the Boolean operators? And negation and conjunction, implication, by implication, etc. So we have extensional operators like or, implies, etc., and it has its corresponding counterparts. They are intentional disjunction, intentional implication, that is strict implication. He recommends us to retain both extensional and intentional disjunction or implication. The material implication seem to be serving our purpose in many number of situations. So it captures mathematical reasoning. We can capture mathematical reasoning in a better way based on this material implication. But when it comes to day-to-day reasoning and other kinds of reasoning that you come across, usually we call it as common sense reasoning, it may not help us much. So adding a new non-Boolean operator, so that is intentional disjunction, which is represented as R with the letters E, bearing the intuitive reading that either A or B, or perhaps necessarily either A or B. That is what we mean by A or B. It is not simply like A or B, but it is A or B, or perhaps even necessarily one of the things have to be necessary. So that is what you mean by intentional disjunction. You talk about intentional disjunction of anything A or B, at least one of the disjunct has to be necessarily true. So now the moment you bring in necessity operators, that is an intentional kind of operator, so it becomes non-Boolean anyway. So A strictly implies B stands for the intuitive meaning. The intuitive meaning of this one is this: A strictly implies B, and it is referring to intentional disjunction. If you simplify it, then it will become not A or B, not A or B, not A or exclusive, sorry, not A, intentional disjunction B. So here is the quotation which is taken from the book, I think, C.I. Lewis, Implication and Algebra of Logic. It was published in Mind. It says like this: the expositors of the algebra of logic have not always taken pains to indicate that there is a difference between algebraic and ordinary meaning of implication. Algebraic implication is simply seems to be material implication, whereas ordinary meaning of implication may seem to be a little bit different. So he is of the view that we have here the further further purpose is to develop a calculus based upon the meaning of implies, such that P implies Q will be synonymous to Q is deducible from P. Material implication will not serve our purpose, but P strictly implies Q, according to him is serving our purpose. The relation of material implication, which figures in most logistic calculus of proportions, that is what you find it in the Principia of Mathematica, and followed by that there are various axiomatic systems, Hilbert, Ackermann, etc. It does not accord with this usual meaning of implies. Implies means, according to Lewis, is not material implication, it is strict implication, which is defined as it is not possible that P is true and Q is false. So it leads to those paradoxes, such as a false proposition implies every proposition, or a true proposition is implied by any strange kind of proposition, which have been set forth in so and so chapter. We are going to see it is entirely possible so to develop calculus of propositions that it accords with the usual meaning of implies. Usual meaning of implies is strict implication, according to C.I. Lewis. He is of the view that material implication failed to capture what he calls it as deduction. When you say that Q is deduced from P, material implication fails to capture it. Strict implication is like this: X represents this thing. It is impossible that A is true. Then we write it like this: not of something is impossible that X is the case. Then you write it like this: not followed by diamond operator and X. So now these are some of the definitions that he comes up with in his axiomatic systems from S1 to S5. A strictly implies B means not a intentional disjunction. B, or you are saying that it is impossible that A is true and B is false. In the second one, A is strictly equivalent to B, provided A strictly implies B and B strictly implies Q, B strictly implies A. And A intentional disjunction B means, by definition, it is not possible that both A and B are false. A strictly implies B, it can be defined as in another way, that is, it is impossible that A is true and B is false. In the same way, A intentional conjunction B, that is what you are finding it in 6. So that is nothing but not of possibility of A and B. A and B are said to be consistent. Possibility only, possibility of A and B. So A and B are said to be consistent. It is possible that both A and B are true. So like this, you know, conjunction can be defined in terms of strict implication. Intentional disjunction is defined in terms of strict implication, like this. So this is what is the case: P implies Q, or Q implies P. That is, P strictly implies Q, and P and Q implies P and Q. These are two theorems in material implication. In the case of strict implication, P strictly implies Q, or it has to be the case that Q strictly implies Q. Q strictly implies P, and P and Q strictly implies P strictly implies Q, all are considered to be theorems. So one interesting example try to consider. So that is like this. This allows us to distinguish material implication and the strict implication. So the example goes like this. Here is a debate between the prosecutor and the defense lawyer in a court. This is a very simple kind of argument, but let us try to see or feel particularly about this argument in particular, why you require strict implication. So it is like this. So the prosecutor is saying like this: if Ravi is guilty, he had an accomplice. That means whenever Ravi commits some kind of whenever he is said to be guilty, is always accompanied by someone else or other. He never commits crime without others. Others help. Alone he cannot commit crime. So I am not analyzing this particular kind of sentence. It is a simple kind of argument which goes in the court, let us say. So now the defense lawyer, obviously there will be a defense lawyer and there will be a prosecutor. So you will be going to the defense lawyer and then prosecutor will be arguing against the defense lawyer. So he is trying to defend the culprit or whatever it is, and prosecutor will be going against what the defense lawyer says. So the defense lawyer says, I disagree with prosecutor. It looks so simple, that his argument is simple, but you know, you have to assume that he has provided enough evidence, and with that evidence he could come up with this kind of conclusion that I disagree with the prosecutor. So that means whatever he is saying, he is denying it. So now ultimately there will be a debate between prosecutor and the defense lawyer, and ultimately judge has to take a decision. So judge, either he has to depending upon the arguments of prosecutor and defense lawyer, judge makes his own conclusion, and his conclusion is that I agree with whatever defense lawyer says seems to be convincing for the judge. That's why he is saying this particular kind of sentence. So now if you just follow classical logic, and this is simply translated as this thing: Ravi is guilty is represented as G, and he had an accomplice is represented as A. So this is first sentence is this thing. So this is what is the prosecutor is trying to do. Now the defense lawyer says that I disagree. That means whatever he is saying, he disagree, not of G plus A. So judge, ultimately judge passes this conclusion: I agree with the defense, means this is the conclusion, that means D only, not of G plus A. So now from this you can conclude this thing, G and not A, because G plus A is not G or A, and not of not G or A is G and not A. So from this, whenever you have P and Q, you can always deduce Q. So from this you can say that G is considered to be guilty. So now this is not of interest to us. We are following the definition of material implication, and then we have come up with the view that Ravi is considered to be guilty. There is no way in which you can escape. When I just say simple letter G, that means it stands for G is considered to be actually guilty. Now if you take the same argument in the case of modal logic, in particular this sentence is represented as it is necessary that G implies A. So this is what is prosecutor is saying. Now defense lawyer is negating this one, G implies A. So now judge, he passes his judgment, and then is exactly accepting this particular kind of thing. So now this is same as this one. So this is the final judgment that he is passing it, so which is different from this one. Let us try to see in what way it is different from this. So this, by definition, we have this thing. Whenever you have not of x, so this means it is possible that not x is the case. So now you push the negation inside, and negation of necessity will become diamond operator, that is possibility, and G implies A. So this becomes G and not A. So now there is a difference between G and not A, and it is possible that G and not A. So now we have a theorem which we need to do it in the next class. In particular, we need to prove this particular theorem when the context comes. We have a theorem which tells us that possibility of G and A implies possibility of G and possibility of A. Suppose if this is considered to be a theorem, then individually it is distributive kind of property, the possibility of G and possibility of A. Now substitute not A for A, this will become this G and not A, and then possibility not A. Now these two modus ponens, this 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 and 6, 5 and 6 modus ponens, you will get this one. It is possible that G, and it is possible that not here. So ultimately what you are trying to conclude is this thing, it is possible that G is the case. So there is a difference between possibility of G and G and necessity of G. That is what we are all trying to make it, I am trying to make this particular kind of point, and this triggers us to do modal logic. Otherwise, if there is no distinction between possibility of G, G and necessity of G, all the modal distinction collapses and we are just simply talking about the proposition logic. So now it is possible that G means it is possible that Ravi is considered to be guilty. So there is a difference in stating that it is possible that it is raining outside and it is actually raining. It is possible that it is raining, it does not imply that it is actually raining. It is possible that I may be something else, but that does not mean that I am actually that particular kind. So possible that P does not imply P. So we want to make this particular kind of distinction, and then if you view this thing without referring to intentional and extensional disjunctions etc., then in the one set of argument you have reached to a conclusion that it is actually G, and in other set of conclusion you have reached with a conclusion possibility of G. So there is a way in which you can escape from the thing. It is possible that G automatically implies that it is also possible that not G is the case. He is not also said to be guilty. There is always some kind of element of doubt. It leaves us some kind of doubt if you argue in this way. If you argue in this way, there is no way to escape from it. So everything is, G is considered to be actually true. So with a, so Lewis has come up with various axiomatic systems, so that they are like this. You know, he has come up with various axiom systems which are S1, S2, S3, etc. So ultimately, what is of importance to us is, for the sake of strict implication, he views it in such a way that S1 and S2 seems to be capturing this strict implication in a much more better. So out of this S1 to S5, these are considered to be the most important systems. First two systems he called it, first three systems he called it as non-normal modal logical systems, and the S4 and S5 he views it as normal modal logical systems. In the next class we will be talking about the language of modal logic, where we will be talking about syntax and the semantics of it. Thank you.